Good evening to you all and good morning from San Francisco. I'm ready to begin the class and I'd request whoever is willing and able to please put on your video cameras. Thank you. So it looks like we have only about 11 participants. We should have about 16 or 17. I got an email from Daniel that he can't be here today, but I'm hoping some others may join. Is there any particular events or things happening that might cause a higher degree of absenteeism today?
There's no Zoom link on my courses.
Well, I'm sorry about that, but is there some
way? Maybe that's why some people haven't found it, because I use the Zoom link from the syllabus.
Right. Is there some way to get the message to everybody to use the same link as every other day? It's not really different. Maybe I can send an email, right? So just give me a minute to send an email to everybody. Okay, I sent an email to everybody. I hope they get it and can join soon. Yeah, so today I want to start by giving some thoughts again on the HubSpot Motion AI case, because you know, you all did your presentations, but there wasn't much time to discuss it or explain things. It's a pretty complex case, so I would like to spend a few minutes going over some aspects of that. Then we'll cover the homework from chapter 11. Then we'll get into the last chapter, the theory chapter for today on pricing, chapter 12. And then I hope to have some time to answer some questions about the final exam. If you want me to review certain concepts, then I'm happy to do that. But before I begin, are there any questions of an administrative nature you would like to bring up? Okay. So I'm going to revisit the HubSpot case, but the way I'm going to do it is by showing you a slide from Petri's PowerPoint, or rather from his PDF. You know, a lot of the HubSpot case centers around the funnel, right? Middle, top of the funnel, middle of the funnel, and bottom of the funnel. So I want to make sure that we understand this concept well, right? So this is the six-step marketing funnel for B2B marketing, which is done through inbound methods, right? The whole value proposition of HubSpot, even before the Motion AI acquisition, is that it does inbound marketing, which is a more passive or laid-back form of marketing. It doesn't involve cold calls, right? You start with a website and you have people visiting the website. You make them register if they are interested, then they become leads. You cultivate the leads by letting them, you know, engage with the content on your website, right? So they might download white papers, they might want to attend a webinar. All of these, those things give them points which help to qualify them. And when each lead passes some threshold number of points, then they become a sales lead. That means they are handed over from the automated system to some salesperson or the sales system. And then those people work on them some more, convert it into opportunities. And opportunity is, yes, they are going to buy within the next quarter. Okay. So there is interest, there is ability, there is also intent to close. The customer does need the product within a short time frame. That becomes an opportunity. And then finally, if you are able to beat the competition, they will become your customer. And of course, this is only the marketing and sales funnel. But beyond that, after six will come the post-sale customer service, right? So when, you know, HubSpot has got a number of different products, the first one is called the Marketing Hub, which is really the entire, it addresses the entire six steps. It is the highest end in the range, right? It starts with content marketing at the top to get more traffic and visitors. And then it goes all the way down to converting them into customers. The next, and that's high end, it goes all the way up to $2,400 a month. The Sales Hub, it is a more modest offering because it's from $50 to $400 a month. So it's more concerned with just the sales aspects. It doesn't deal much with the content marketing up front or at the top. And then there's the Customer Hub, which is free, which is really after step number six. It's the customer service aspect of it, right? And then there is another product that HubSpot had even before the Motion AI acquisition, which was GrowthBot. And GrowthBot is just their own internal chat bot, which is an interface where they are using with Customer Hub. So currently, if a customer has some customer service questions, then that's handled through the GrowthBot, which is a chat bot. So remember, HubSpot already had a bot product in place, GrowthBot, before it acquired Motion AI. So now that you understand where, you know, what are the products of, you know, HubSpot and where in the funnel are these going to be used, the whole problem going forward from September 2017 is how to integrate the new Motion AI technology into HubSpot specific products and where they will be applied in the marketing funnel. So let me see if I can have any reactions to just understanding what the problem is in the case. is it quite clear that, you know, basically the people at Motion AI, the top three people who are now part of HubSpot, they have to decide, you know, where to integrate the new technology into HubSpot's four products and which part of the funnel should these be applied to.
Didn't they say that they already applied it to each part to an extent and they tried it out that way?
Yeah, they've done some you know, internal testing, but eventually they need to have a more clear direction after whatever data they've collected from their tests. It's still about which products and which applications the new technology should kind of stabilize on, right? That's the strategic decision to be made. And especially if they want to launch it externally, right? And create some either revenue opportunities or just value enhancing opportunities. So it's really about a kind of market launch decision, because they've done all these internal things, but they need to figure out how to deploy it and make money out of it.
Well, I don't know. It seemed from what I understand the case is that it would be applied to all levels. Because for each level, I mean, it wouldn't be applied to the end funnel where they were specifically talking about that they needed to use like human personnel on the very end of the funnel. But like for the early and middle stage, I at least I understood it in the way that it will be applied to both.
Yeah, that's what the analysis and the recommendations have to deal with, right? You could conceivably apply it to all four products and use it at all parts of the funnel, but you could also say, let's focus a little more, right? I think they still are at that point where they need help with deciding the way forward. So I'm not advocating which is the right way. I'm just trying to draw the boundaries of the problem first.
Yeah, but right? from my understanding, sorry, just to clarify, it's the fact that there is no real opportunity cost in focusing on what you use the AI for, because it's a electronic product. There's no like is there like a clear opportunity cost? Because that's why I don't really I don't see like there is, of course, at to some extent there's like a limit where it will go like above the capacities of their computers and whatever, but at least that I don't think was implied in the case at all, that it's like anywhere near that consumption. So
the opportunity cost is that they've already spent quite a bit of money on the acquisition, right?
So
either they have to recover that or they can sell it off if it's a no-go.
Oh, I guess it's fair,
right? I mean, it is the fiduciary responsibility of the management that if they made a wrong decision in the acquisition, then cut your losses and, you know, get out of it, and all assets can be sold, right? So that's where I come in with, you know, it's a strategic problem, right? And then, you know, if I could just go back to this, I absolutely agree that it could be used at any stage of the funnel, but you know, one aspect of consumer behavior that I would like to bring to your attention is that as people, as prospects or visitors get into this funnel, and as they proceed downwards, do you see how their knowledge and familiarity increases? At the beginning, when they first make contact with HubSpot's website, they may know nothing about inbound marketing. Right? while they are going down through this process, they are learning about the product and what can it do and so on and so forth. So the questions that they need answered are likely to be of a very elementary or simplistic nature on the top of the funnel. But as they learn more, their questions will get a little more deeper and more complex because they already have some baseline knowledge, right? And so my point of view is that although the chatbot can be used in any part of the funnel, its use will probably decline from the top of the funnel to the bottom of the funnel. And the human element will probably increase from the top of the funnel to the bottom of the funnel, right? Like when you come to the last stage number 6 of closing the deal, the customer is going to ask all kinds of tough questions about the competition, about bargaining and negotiating about the price, and then the chatbot will not be able to do those kinds of things. So again, I do feel that some understanding of B2B customer behavior is necessary in order to inform your decisions about the applications, you know. And therefore, similarly, when you consider the products, you know, the GrowthBot is HubSpot's own alternative to a chatbot. So that's a pretty simple decision to compare chatbot's performance with Motion AI's performance, and then maybe you just need one product, whichever is the best, or you might want to integrate the two, because you know, one is an internal product. There is an exhibit in the case which shows the kinds of interactions that are possible with GrowthBot. It's really very simple, like asking for, you know, how can I understand some more features of HubSpot's product? So they are very simple customer service questions. So when it comes to the post sale after 6, when you get into customer service, you really, HubSpot has two options, the former GrowthBot and the new Motion AI. You have to compare the two and either, you know, accept the better one going forward, or somehow combine the best features and benefits of both into one customer service product. And then when it comes to the you know, other three products, the marketing hub has got much more of content marketing, and it's more at the top of the funnel, so the chatbot could be probably integrated more into the marketing hub, and the sales hub is more to do with after stage 3, you know, where they are already in the middle of the funnel. So there maybe you start reducing the chatbot, and then that's how you will try to do this. Remember, when you do a technology acquisition like this, you have to plan a roadmap. How am I going to use this in 2018, 2019, 2020? Which are the features that will, from Motion AI, that we will use in our earlier versions of the product short term, and which ones will we incorporate in the future? That is called a technology roadmap or a product roadmap. And that's something which is very strategic, and HubSpot has to do that. That's what I hope your recommendations will deal with. So again, that's all I want to say about the case. You know, you have to define the problem, you have to discuss what options HubSpot has, and then you have to make some recommendations about how to integrate the technology into HubSpot's future roadmap, product roadmap. So any thoughts or reactions? Okay, it looks like, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, just to mention it, at least for me, it was a little bit, the main problem with the case is a little bit unclear of what, in what way we were supposed to comment on it. So, but I think that clarifies at least like the point of the case. And, I don't know.
Yeah, so again,
let me see my mistakes at least. And what I've done.
Yeah, thank you, Eric. It's all about learning, right? I mean, that's why I'm going over this, is because I know it's a complex case and it's fine. I haven't yet read the memos. I will read them and give you feedback. But this is the point of all of marketing strategy is, you know, you have many opportunities and you have limited resources. And how do you focus on those areas which will bring about the maximum return for the company? And in this case, we dealt perhaps too much into some nitty-gritty elbow grease. But remember, this is where you will find yourselves when you're in your jobs, right? You will just be thrown into situations and told, go figure it out, what's going on. It's a very different business environment than in school, right? So that's what these long case studies help you to do, is to start figuring out how to learn by yourself. What are the major problems? What are the alternative solutions? What are some recommendations you are willing to back up with data, with logic, with theory? That's my hope. Any other comments or closing thoughts on the case? Okay, I still see only 12 participants. I've sent the email, so it's table at 12. So I'm going to do a quick roll call now. Please answer to your name. Hafiz? Antoine? Ridwan?
Yes, I'm here.
Ella?
Yeah, I'm here.
Eric is here. Daniel is not here. Simal?
Yeah.
Thank you. Rasmus? Kalle?
I'm here.
Thank you. Emma? Emma is not here. Elisa?
Yeah, I'm here.
Thank you. Alexi?
Yes, I'm here.
Thank you. Sarah Maria? Thank you. I can see you. Jade?
Yeah, I'm here.
You are okay. And G?
Here.
Thank you. Now I would like to go to the chapter 11 homework. I'm sorry, Tina, I didn't call your name, right?
Yes.
Okay. I marked you present. Thank you. Anybody else I forgot to call? Okay. So now I want to go to the homework on chapter 11. So this is about a distribution, which we talked about yesterday. One, two, three, four, five. I have only three teams which answered the homework. So there does seem to be some something going on in terms of your workload or things like that that are preventing people from meeting the deadlines. Any thoughts about what might be going on? It just helps me to understand my students better. Up until now, all five teams had responded. Now I see only three.
I don't know. My best guess is summer vacation is the.
Are you guys doing more than?
Maybe you just need to refresh the page.
Oh, okay.
Because I saw a few teams put it close.
Oh, yes. Who was it who suggested I refresh the page?
Me, Ella.
Thank you, Ella. Okay, I see that everybody has participated. I'm pleased to know that, even if it's at the last minute, but you got it in, that's good. So now I would like to go to the questions. So let's start with the first question about the magic roundabout. And I'm going to place this, share the screen on the okay, let's read this and then we'll come back to the question. So this is about sustainability. And essentially, this is the diagram which talks about trying to design clothes and fabric so that there is zero waste. And what do you do if you want to have zero waste is you try to reuse, recycle, and repair things, right? Okay, so this is the case. Now let's go back to the question. Explain figure 11.1 with an example of a different company that has not been mentioned in the box. From the snapshot, it is clear that companies can benefit from recycle and remanufacturing. For example, Renault. Levi's is the company that has not been mentioned and their method of being sustainable. Levi's, for example, lets their customers drop off unwanted clean dry garments or shoes at branches of the denim retailer. And in turn, the customer receives a 10% discount to use on full priced clothing. This in turn helps increase the return rates of the products. Okay, so this is a good example. My question for the team is, what does Levi's do with the products that are returned? Any thoughts? Anybody out there from team number one? It says, you know, that Levi's allows customers to bring in old reused products and gives them a discount to buy new ones, which is good. But then my question is, you have all these returned products. What do you do with them? If you burn them, you're not following the spirit of the diagram, right? You've got to be able to reuse them in some fashion. So do you know what Levi's is doing with the return clothes? And even if you do not, then my question is, how would you, if you were the managers at Levi and you had all these returned clothes, what would you do with them in order to make it more zero waste? Any thoughts? So let me ask specifically, is Hafiz here, Emma and Anton? Can you guys answer my question?
I don't think
any of the crew members. They're
not here. Let's see. Hafiz, Anton, and Emma. Okay, I'm sorry, they're not here. So that's not a fair question. Let me ask others, because I'm discussing this for the benefit of the whole class. If you were the managers at Levi, what would you do with all these returned garments in order to be more in line with the zero waste principle? Any thoughts? Do you understand my concern is that if you're just collecting all this and you're just burning it, then that's kind of not being consistent with the principle, right?
Yeah, well, I don't know the answer, but I would guess that materials can be used in making different products, or then the material can be sold forward. So for example, if someone would return like jeans or something, you could make another product that is like that the jeans material can be used in.
Yes, is that Ella?
No, it's Jade.
Jade, thank you. So see, if you don't put your camera on, I can't really see who's answered, but I do have to give points for class participation. That's why I'm asking who the person was. Well, you know, that's one approach, is to completely disassemble the product and then try to reuse the material, but that's more difficult. What is more common is that these products get sold in developing countries where they cannot afford, you know, first quality jeans, right? There are many charitable and non-profits which will take the product from Levi's and then distribute it in some poor countries in Africa, perhaps. Okay, so at least you reuse it, you know. Jade, what you suggested requires more of processing, and that means cost. But clearly they could easily donate the products to other needy countries where this will have a new lease of life. So that would be a good way to, you know, continue along the cycle. Okay, let's go to another question. Question number 5, which is on Hungry Caterpillar. So let me go there. Just trying to find the right box. So are you able to now see the Hungry Caterpillar box? Okay, let's read that and then come back to the question. Okay, so here we have Caterpillar, which has not performed well for 4 years, and they're coming out of this with a strategy to be more lean and profitable. They want to focus on developing countries like Africa, Middle East, China, and India. They want to provide better service, and they want to target 3 customer groups: large customers, customers with dealer relationships, and first-time customers who want a more e-commerce type of experience. It has 171 independent-owned dealers in these countries, and it expects that they will focus not so much on new equipment sales. You know, that's probably makes sense because these are developing markets. Those customers may better able to afford used equipment or some kind of lease or rental arrangement. Caterpillar wants dealers to orientate towards fleet management businesses. So fleets are generally large companies which have multiple Caterpillar units, right? They may even be leasing companies. So Caterpillar could sell 100 tractors to a leasing company, and then that leasing company will in turn lease out to farmers. So the fleet management is again business to business sales. Distributors already offered a tiered fleet management system branded as Cat Equipment Management Solutions or EMS. Caterpillar wants dealers to move more customers onto higher levels of EMS, particularly those where the dealer handles equipment monitoring or actually takes over management of customers' fleet of equipment. So notice how they are kind of transitioning away from equipment into services. You know, monitoring means they've got all kinds of hardware and software to say whether the tractor might need maintenance, right? Give them alerts and so on. Second, Caterpillar is also asking distributors to increase its share of the global parts and service market, the aftermarket. The aim being to reach sales of 25 billion. So not just the first time sale, but also the aftermarket sale. The company believes that dealers can make more of the technology deployed in Caterpillar's machines to not only move more towards equipment monitoring, but also to support parts and service revenue growth. So again, there are sensors in the equipment which might tell you that a part is close to end of its life, so replace it before it breaks down. Preventive maintenance. Okay, so this is its new strategy. Now let's see what the question and the answer is. So team number 5's question: what should Caterpillar do to get leaders to move more customers onto higher levels of EMS, like handling equipment monitoring or managing customers' equipment fleets? What should Caterpillar do to get dealers to increase sales in the parts and service aftermarket? So here's their answer. We think that what Caterpillar faces with its distributors is a very basic marketing problem: how to sell more products to customers that are already satisfied. Caterpillar has identified that these products are useful, but the customers are not necessarily convinced so easily. The basic way to achieve this goal would be to share the data and research that Caterpillar has done, but many small distributors may be quite resistant to change. appealing first primarily to large distributors and then using their success to incorporate the rest would be more cost-effective approach, best approach for them. If this is successful, it would increase the demand. There's also potential in the underdeveloped markets for EMS and further for aftermarket sales. The scenario does not discuss them in enough detail to make a strong case. But from our own experience, China and India in particular would have enough demand to establish a solid long-term relationship with local distributors. Middle East and Africa might run into problems with reliable distributor stability and infrastructure. Okay, so what I like about this answer is that you're already segmenting the market, putting China and India ahead of Middle East and Africa. You know, this is just in terms of the economic analysis, you know, where is the infrastructure better? Where is the sort of customer affordability better, right? So I would agree that probably in 2018, China and India were in a better position to make use of all these heavy equipment. Remember, there's a building boom in both China and India, probably more so than Middle East and Africa. Lots of housing construction, lots of, you know, manufacturing construction, right? Infrastructure, roads, bridges, all of those. So that's a good recommendation. Now, the one thing I will add is that, you know, the business customers, and this may have been alluded to in the farm electronics case. You remember that they said that customers in India are not very good at paying up in time, that they take a long credit time period, right? This generally shows that they are very price sensitive, right? It is, after all, developing countries, both China and India. So the customer mentality is more, you know, I don't need to worry about this until it breaks down. You know, they're not so into preventive maintenance and all these services, right? They say, oh, when it breaks down, that's when we will take care of it. So that's going to be a challenge for Caterpillar. And probably the best way to handle that would be to try to convert it into some kind of easy installment monthly pay plan. Okay. Instead of annual contracts, you know, annual contracts might seem quite high priced to some of these developing country customers. The fleet, especially the fleet management systems, where they have lots of them. But again, many of the fleet management systems are larger companies who might be a little more sophisticated in terms of their, you know, saving costs over the lifetime of the product. So this is an important concept. I don't know if we've discussed it before in the course, the total life cycle cost of the product. You know, that's something that could be used in terms of marketing in China and India, is that if you say that we'll use the product until it breaks down, then factor in the cost of the downtime. Because if you don't have the contract with us, then you will get lower priority as a customer. Your tractor may be down for 3 days. And what is the cost of that? If you factor that in, maybe it's better to invest in a preventive maintenance and service contract. So these are the kinds of selling propositions that you will have to try out to address the price sensitivity of the customer. So let me pause and see if either the team members or anybody else has any comments about their answer.
Well, I mean, that was a fair point. We didn't really take into account when we were asking the, thinking the answer was the price sensitivity part of this application. I mean, of course, it's a factor. It just didn't really cross our mind. So it's good to think about those kind of factors. So.
And you know, one of the things we know about, at least I know about India, is we've had a huge increase in the middle class, and probably in China as well, right? What has fueled that in terms of consumer financing is this method of equal monthly installment plan. You know, whether you're buying a car or whether you're buying a home, the whole cost of everything is amortized into monthly payments. Then people are able to afford. They may not have any savings. Whatever income they have for the whole month will go in paying their debt. But at least they'll have those, either those necessities or those status symbols of middle class affluence. So even business customers could learn from that and say, yeah, we can try. We'll have to be more creative on the financing aspect. Okay. So I think that's all the time I have for discussing the homeworks. I will read all the rest and, you know, give you more comments on that. So now we need to get to chapter 12 on pricing, which is the last theory chapter. And then you will have all those chapters on the final exam. So let me go to the PowerPoint here. So I hope you can see the slide. Right, so before I start talking specifically about this slide, we are now on the fourth P of the marketing mix. We've already covered promotion. We covered, you know, product. We covered yesterday place, and today is pricing. One important insight I want to share with you is that price is the only one of the four P's that brings revenue into the company. All the other three P's are cost factors. If you want to promote the product, you have to invest in advertising, in personal selling, in website, in marketing automation software, all of those things. If you want to develop a product, you have to hire R&D engineers. You have to give them budgets. You have to build prototypes, right? If you want to get into distribution, again, you have to have a sales force to support your channel members. In case there is channel conflict, you have to iron out those aspects. So just think about it. Price is the only one of the four P's that brings in cash. All the other three P's are cash, you know, drains. And therefore, you have to be very careful about how you price your products as a marketeer. You know, price is the only thing that pays the bills, the salaries of people, the rent of the premises. All of the things that you need to keep the business operating. And yet, therefore, it is so critical that we shouldn't change it frequently. Would you agree? Because it is something that is the lifeblood. It is bringing oxygen into the company. So you should not tinker with it too much. And yet, the trap is that it is so easy to change price. It is the most easy to change of the four P's. If you want to change promotion, product, or distribution, that'll take some time. That'll take some work. But price, you just publish a new price list, either on the web or in your brochures, and then you are ready to distribute it. So this is the dilemma of pricing. It should not be changed often because it is such a critical aspect of the company's, you know, operations, and yet it is the easiest to change. And guess what? When salespeople are in competition to close an order, they always put pressure on the company to give discounts and close the order. But it is the marketing people who take a longer term view who have to push back the salespeople and tell them, no, you got to sell at the price we set, because otherwise, you know, other aspects of the company's operations will be affected. So this creates some tension between sales and marketing. Sales always wants low prices and discounts to close the sale. Salespeople are compensated on commission based on revenue they bring in. But the marketing people, especially at headquarters level, they are the ones who have to be responsible for profits, not just revenue. And so, you know, in good companies, the decisions on price are made at a fairly high level within the organization. Salespeople rarely have discretion over price. They have to get permission if they want to lower the price or give discounts. Okay. And so having said that, it is very obvious going to the slide that price has a very direct and substantial effect on profitability. And here is some remarkable statistic. A 5% increase in price will increase profit by 22%. A 5% increase in sales or revenue increases by only 12% the profit, and a 5% reduction in cost increases profit by 10%. Okay, so you can see how price increases result in greater profitability than either revenue increases or cost reductions. The three C's of pricing, you might have come across it in other courses. You know, your costs, your unit costs set the floor on pricing. You cannot price below unit costs, otherwise you will go out of business. So cost is the threshold. You have to price above costs. The ceiling on price is set by customers' willingness to pay. Every customer's has a maximum price they are willing to pay. Think of our own behaviors, right? We know what we should pay for a haircut or if we have to buy an ice cream, right? We know what it is. So we are not willing to pay if suddenly the price goes too much higher. And then in between the floor and the ceiling, the price is determined by competitive positioning. So you've got to look at what your competitors' prices are. If you feel that your positioning is higher or better than them, you will charge higher than the competitors. If you feel you're a Me Too product, you will charge the same price as competitors. And if you're an unknown brand and you're just trying to get a toehold in the market, you will try to price lower than the competitors. Okay? So that gives rise to different types of pricing strategy. Okay, this is one of the historical ways in which prices have been set. It's called cost plus pricing. What it says is first you have to work out what is the unit cost of your product. And the unit cost has two components, the variable costs of production, which in this first line are 575 pounds. Now, what are variable costs? Variable costs are direct costs that can be traced to one unit of the product. So if you're making a pair of jeans, then you can actually figure out, you know, how much of denim material is this using, how many rivets or buttons does metal pieces go into it, right? That's called direct materials. And then if you are outsourcing this, the assembly of the jeans to a contract manufacturer who charges you on a piece rate, that is per jean, they may charge you, you know, £4 or something like that, £5. I don't know the exact number, but that's when you will add up the direct labor and the direct materials to get the variable cost. The allocated overhead costs. Overhead costs are fixed costs. This is like the rental for your offices, the salary, fixed salary for your workers, right? So that has, you know, fixed costs don't vary with the volume of production, but then they can be allocated to a unit of the product. So let's say that allocated overhead cost is 349. Your full unit cost of production is 575 plus 349, which is 924. The company may have a desired profit margin, 20%. So you add 20% on top of the cost of production, that's £1.85, and that's the final selling price, 11.09. How do you calculate overhead? Let's say the total overhead cost for the factory, including salaries, the cost of power, the rental, all of those things is about £150,000. And let's say you expect the factory will be able to produce and sell 43,000 units. Then you divide the total overhead by the expected volume. That gives £3.49, which goes into the second line in the computation above. Now, my friends, the question I have for you is, what's the problem with cost plus pricing? Is that a good method of pricing, or are there problems with it?
I mean, the main problem is that you're not meeting the supply demand equilibrium. You're not like pricing at the most efficient point. You're not pricing at the market value, you're pricing at the minimum amount of value that, or minimum price that you can operate on, basically.
Right. This only takes into account one C, that is cost. It doesn't take into account competitors, and it doesn't take into account customers' willingness to pay, right? So you might find, you set it at £11, the price, but customers might think it's too high, or they may think it's too low, right? Your competitors may be at £9. What's the use of a price if customers don't buy? So it's rather insensitive to the other two C's of pricing factors. And indeed, we have to say that nowadays, with global competition from all over the world, especially from low-cost manufacturing countries, this model of pricing is out of the door. Hardly anybody uses it unless you're in a very monopolistic situation. Okay? Nowadays, we have to take the customer's willingness to pay, and we have to take the competitors' prices into account. First, you set the market price, then you deduct your profit margin, and then you get a target cost. You go to your R&D developers and product developers and say, you know, can you make me a widget within £7? Because the market will only bear £9 for this product. So then, pricing becomes an input into design. Pricing becomes an input into manufacturing. You cannot wait for the design and the manufacture and then do the pricing. It's too late. Do you see where I'm going with this? Any thoughts or reactions? Okay, now I have to ask, have you done break-even analysis in any other course? Does this term ring a bell? Break-even analysis?
I think I heard about it, yeah.
In which course?
I don't remember either, but like I've heard about it, but
okay,
can't remember where or like any details.
Okay.
I think we also did like in operations management or maybe the last marketing course.
Okay.
Yeah.
So since only one or two of you may have remembered what that is, it's an extremely important concept. So I want to get into it in a fair amount of detail, but I'll do that after we take our 5-minute break. So it's 3 past the hour now. Let's come back at 8 past the hour. Thank you. Okay, I'm back after the break, and I'd request everybody else to join in after the break as well. Can I have a few more video cameras on, please? Thank you. Right. So we're going to talk about break-even analysis next. And I want to recap your memory on the concept of the product life cycle, which we did in the product chapter. Do you remember that S-shaped curve, which has those 4 stages, introduction, growth, maturity, and decline? If you remember, there were two S-shaped curves. One was for sales and the other was for profit. And what did we see? That in the introduction stage, you start having little bit of sales, but you have negative profit. It's only later in growth that profit becomes positive. And the reason why, when you introduce a new product, let's say you're a startup and you're launching your first product, you have to first incur a lot of fixed costs, right? You have to hire people, you have to rent an office, right? You might have to spend on advertising to spread awareness of your product. So because of all these high fixed costs, even if you're selling the product, it takes a while for you to become profit positive. That volume at which you transition from negative to positive profit is called break-even volume. Okay, so what is break-even volume? It is the number of units that need to be sold before a company becomes profitable. Very simple. Is it quite clear? Now, I'm going to draw some diagrams and derive a very simple algebraic formula where you will really understand the nitty-gritty of that. So I'm going to go to my document camera for a moment. Right, so I hope this is somewhat visible. I'm going to write something here. Break-even volume. Can you see that? Yes. Now I'm going to draw a diagram. this is volume, and this is euro or dollar or whatever. So fixed cost doesn't vary with volume. So this is fixed cost. This is the what you have to pay for salaries, rental, right? Power, utilities, all of those things. Okay. Then there is variable cost per unit, which is how much does it cost to produce more and more products. That's like over here, variable cost, right? Actually, this is the total cost. The actual variable cost will start from zero and go there. So this one is total cost, because the actual variable cost will start somewhere like this. If you don't produce any units, you're not incurring any variable cost. If you produce X amount of units, your variable cost will be on a straight line from zero. But if you add every point on the variable cost line to every point on the fixed line, then you get the total cost. Is it clear? Then you have revenue. Revenue is what? Price times volume. So it also starts at zero and it goes like this. This is revenue. Okay. And the point at which the revenue line crosses the total cost line is the break-even volume. So simple. But it's a very powerful concept. And what it enables you to do is to work out a simple formula. You know, what is profit? Profit is equal to revenue minus total cost. And what is revenue? Revenue is the price times the quantity, which is this line, price times the quantity minus fixed cost plus variable cost. What is variable cost? That's little v is the variable cost per unit times the volume. Right? So this is your simple profit equation. If you want to make it zero, which is break even profit, zero loss, that will be P times Q minus FC minus V times Q. Right? So now if you isolate the Q, which is the break even volume, this will equal to the fixed cost divided by P minus little v, which is fixed cost divided by contribution margin. Contribution margin is an accounting term which simply means price y minus variable cost per unit. Okay, so this is how you derive the formula for break-even volume. So why is this important? You know, if there is an entrepreneur who is trying to acquire a new factory to start up some operation, it knows what its fixed costs are. It knows, you know, what is its desired contribution margin. Perhaps the market price is given and it knows what its variable costs are. So once you have the break-even volume calculated, you have to really ask the sales and marketing question, which is, can we reach this volume or not? Because if it seems reasonable, then it's a go decision to invest in the factory or to go ahead with the launch. But if that break-even volume seems too large, then what do? You could possibly increase the price, which will make the break-even volume lower, right? Or you could reduce the fixed costs, which will also make the break-even volume lower, right? So again, this goes back to simple issues about pricing. How does price affect break-even volume? And how does that affect your decision to launch a new startup or launch a new product? It can be applied at the product level as well. So I'm going to go back to my original camera and see if you have any questions about just this notion of what break-even volume is. Okay, it's quite simple and understood. Good, let's go ahead with the PowerPoint. So this is what I just derived for you. Break-even volume is equal to fixed cost divided by price minus variable cost. This one is again a more complex formula, but what does it say? It says that if your price change, if you increase price, that is over time P2 is greater than P1, then this right hand side will be negative, which means if you increase price, your break even goes down. And if you reduce price, then this right hand side is positive, which means that if you reduce price, your break even volume goes up. That's all it says. And here is some interesting diagrams on elasticity of demand. Normal price elasticity would say that if price goes down, then demand should go up. That is your curve A. That is called elastic demand. If price is reduced on the vertical, then the volume goes up, the demand goes up on the horizontal. Now, line B is more inelastic than A, because it means when price is reduced, yes, volume goes up, but not by a very large amount. So we've made the comment before that B2B products face more inelastic demand because the customers must buy those in order to keep operating. Consumer demand is more elastic because you and I can reduce our consumption to some extent if, you know, prices go up or down. And then C is the most interesting. What does C say? If you start increasing price, then your demand goes up. This is reverse of A. If price goes up, demand goes up. And then after some point, if price keeps increasing, then it will become elastic again. Now, the first part, the inelastic part of this, can be explained in two consumer or two buying behavior situations. One is if there's some prestige or luxury involved in the product, then as price increases, demand may increase. But more often than not, in B2B products, what does a price increase signal? A price increase might signal that there is some shortage of the product. And if there is shortage of the product, it might result in panic buying or stockpiling, as it happened in the early days of COVID, when hospitals and healthcare service providers had to really stockpile on sanitizer and personal protective equipment. The prices were going up and up, but they had no choice but to keep buying it. And they were willing to do that because they expected that the shortage would continue for some time. And then finally, there is an ethical dimension to pricing. You know, we've all heard of things, negative terms like price gouging, right? Very often, pharmaceutical companies are accused of charging very high prices, right? Pharmaceutical companies are accused of charging very high prices, way above what their costs are, and we consider that to be unethical. So here are some different ways to think about ethics and pricing. Five principles. First one is, if the buyer voluntarily pays the agreed price, they are not being coerced. then that's ethical. When both parties have equal information, it's ethical. You know, before we had the internet, it was always, say, sellers of used cars had more information on the condition of the car. The buyer of the used car didn't know much about the internal performance of the car and the engine. So that was a case of asymmetric information, and that favored the sellers, and the buyers got a raw deal. That is unethical. Third is, there should be no exploitation of a buyer's essential needs. You know, some of the basic rights of people have to be given at low cost or no cost. You know, food, shelter, this is where the government has to step in and provide some of those services, and it's the taxpayers who absorb all the cost, right? So if you're not exploiting somebody's essential needs, you know, then you're being ethical. Pricing is ethical where it is justified by costs. In fact, right now there's some inflationary pressures in the US economy, and a lot of companies are taking out ads saying that, you know, including Procter and Gamble, we have to raise our prices in September because all the prices of, you know, paper and pulp and so on are going up. And pricing is ethical where everyone has equal access to goods and services regardless of ability to pay. Again, what are, you know, this is somewhat related to number three, where, you know, basic human rights have to be guaranteed regardless of the ability to pay. So with that, I'll stop here and see if you have any questions about pricing, any of the things I went over, or any other issues you might be interested in about pricing. Do you have any interesting stories or experiences to share about either having scored a great deal in price or feeling that you were exploited in some way by being charged a very high price? Anybody would like to share any of those stories and how it affected you? Hafiz, I see you smiling, but would you like to make a comment?
No, it's not shareable, just thinking. Like, okay. It was very long. Not remember exactly.
So I'll share one story from my global travels. You know, I have a haircut every other month. I don't have that much hair, but at least I try to go see my stylist about once every alternate month. And in the US, you know, standard price for a haircut with a tip included is about $20 US. Okay. When I go to India, I have very good personalized service. You know, they even wash my hair after the cut and shampoo it and all that. It's about $1 US. And then sometimes I've been to Mikkeli or La Piranta in the summer, and there's nothing I can get less than 30 euros. So that's how, you know, it really is a surprise. But then, you know, since I'm a good student of economics, I do understand all the differences that are going on between, you know, the cost of labor, the affordability of the markets, the taxes that have to be paid by businesses in different countries. And so, you know, my natural consumer behavior is to try to pay the lowest cost possible. So, you know, just whenever I'm in India, I'll make sure I get my hair cut there before I leave, right? And I'll try to postpone my haircut in Finland till I get back to the US, right? So those are some of the coping strategies that I follow in terms of my global travels, but I'm interested to see if you all have any stories about pricing from your travels.
I mean, I just remember that that's, I guess, probably for many people, like a common thing for like tourist destinations. If you know the place where you are at and you go you're in a tourist area and you go like one street to the side, the prices will drop like 50% easily. I remember in Japan, there's this very famous street. I don't recall what it's called now. But anyway, there's like a lot of tourist stuff, whatever, random items. And then you, like, food is, of course, very expensive. But then if you go to literally the next street over, you'll get food with like normal prices, which is fairly cheap.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that. So tourist destination retail prices are always high. Airports, the prices are always high. Have you noticed? Anything you buy at an airport, except for duty-free is a whole different deal because you are tax exempt. But you buy a baseball cap or you buy some jacket or something at an airport, it'll cost you a fortune. So that's because they have some territorial protection or some kind of monopoly in that local area. Any other thoughts or experiences to share? Okay. So now there's one more thing I want to do. Just bear with me while I pull this up. So I hope you can see the syllabus. You know, after this chapter's conclusion, I believe that I have delivered all the content that was in the syllabus. And I especially want to revisit the learning outcomes of the course. Okay. I went over this on the first day, but I want to now go over it since we are at the end of our, you know, pretty much all the content. First, I want to ask, do you understand better the distinctions between business marketing and consumer marketing today than when we started out more than 2 weeks ago? The second is, do you understand the theoretical and practical knowledge of understanding business buyers, purchasing practices, and buyer-seller relationships in organizational and cultural contexts? We've done so many case studies, some small homework case studies, some larger case memos. Do you see how the practical knowledge of B2B marketing can help a company like HubSpot decide what's going to be its future roadmap with regard to chatbots? Or how does a farm electronics decide that we need to go after type A customers and have a key account management system? Those are the practical applications which I hope were quite evident throughout the course. And you would also appreciate in three that we haven't discarded any of the general marketing principles, you know. All the consumer marketing that you learned is still valid. It's just that it has to be applied a little bit differently in business marketing. For example, we have joint decision making in B2B marketing, we call that decision-making unit or the buying center. In families, we might have the parents and the children are making, you know, some joint decision about what type of breakfast cereal to buy. But do you see the magnitude and the quality of the joint decision making in the B2B case is so much more rational rather than emotional, and so much more based on evidence and discussion than just tastes or preferences? And finally, are you now able to identify and assess some solutions to business marketing problems, again, through all of the case study analysis? So I just wanted to go over this and make sure that you appreciate all the things that you have engaged in throughout the course. And, you know, it's been a great experience for me. For one, the technology has worked pretty flawlessly. Every online course, I have some doubts, you know, sometimes some things don't work and so on. But I think by and large, this has worked quite well. Again, I'm sorry, this is such a late hour for you in Finland or in Australia, but that's the nature of global business, isn't it? We have to adjust and adapt, and I've tried to make it as user-friendly as possible. But thanks a lot for a good course, and I wish you well in the remaining assignments for, you know, that are due in the next few days and in your future academic and professional careers. So with that, I'm now open to, you know, any kind of review that you would like me to do for the final exam. And we still have about 27 minutes. So, you know, if you feel it's not important for you, you could leave, but I'll be here if you want me to, you know, go over any former concepts in the chapters or give examples or anything of that nature. I'm happy to stay and do that. So tell me, what would you like to do? If you have any questions, you can type them in the chat or you can ask me over the mic. I'm happy to revisit any of the concepts in any of the chapters to help you better prepare for the final exam tomorrow evening.
I don't have a specific question about any specific topic yet, at least. But how do you think is the best way to find all of the concept that we're going to be asked on? Like, for like specifically, like in the last exam, I remember having like missing some of the concepts that we had on the thing. And are the slides the best way to do it, or do you think the book itself? Like, I feel like the book is so verbose, yeah. It's hard to find specific topics. Maybe.
No, I think it's there's not enough time to go back to the original book, right? So the slides would be a logical starting point to review. Clearly, if there's something that I have skipped over, you can cancel that slide. I will not ask you anything that I have not discussed in the Zoom classes, okay? And then you have to try to use your judgment on where were the more interesting discussions, where were their questions, where did I spend more time on, you know? That's how you try to get proxies for which are the more important B2B concepts, which concepts were applied across homeworks and the cases, right? So the whole effort has to be on trying to separate out what do you think are the more important concepts and disregard the less important concepts. That's the best advice I can give you. And, you know, review the homeworks. I think the homeworks could be the second step after the PowerPoints to see what were the examples, because you did only one of the questions, but there were other interesting issues addressed by all the other teams. You know, and then think about what were the concepts used in the farm electronics case, what were the important concepts used in the HubSpot Motion AI case, In other words, you know, you try to prepare your own short list of concepts and just focus in on those. That if I were a student, that's how I would do it. You know, it's not possible to review everything. Clearly, I will not repeat the same concept from the midterm, but there may be related concepts that I ask about. So I think that was a good question, Eric. I don't know if my answer is very helpful, but I'm trying to give you some guidelines. Any other questions or anything you would like me to address in terms of going over some difficult concepts? By the way, if while you are preparing, you come across anything that's not clear, you know, shoot me an email and I will be really fast in responding, because I know the exam is just about less than 24 hours away. You can expect a quick response. Just don't tell me to explain the whole concept. Tell me, give me an example of this concept, or, you know, what does this technical term mean? Give me some concise things that you want me to respond to, and I'll be happy to do that very quickly.
I'm sorry, but does the content for tomorrow's final exam will be from chapter 1 to chapter 12, right?
It will, but somebody, I think Samil asked me yesterday that I said pay more attention to the chapters after the midterm. It's not that there will also be questions, but I think again from the middle of the book onwards may be more focused than right up front.
Okay, thank you.
So again, just to go over, tomorrow is the final exam. On Thursday, you have to do the last case, the individual memo on fan cam. And then on Friday, you have to do the video presentation on fan cam. So do you have any questions about the video presentation or the fan cam? You know, so there's a number of things. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday will be busy for you all. But that's the nature of it, end of course.
Well, I at least don't have anything else to ask. I think I'm ready to prepare for the exam. So for myself, I'll say thank you for the course. And we hope to see you again. I believe you have another course with us at some point. Or is it just this one?
Usually it's only in the summers, but
okay,
who knows.
Well, unfortunately then we will not see again, but thank you very much for this talk.
Thank you, everyone. You know, stay engaged and hang in there for the last 3 days, and I wish you all the best. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Goodbye.